Hi everyone, my name is David. I'm part of the team at Kingdomcity and it's my privilege to be bringing the Word of God to you today. And because we're still in January, my mind, my thoughts are still towards how can we start this year strong? And that's why today I want to talk to you about having a healthy soul. And I'd really like to pray with you right now. So wherever you are, in your lounge room or a larger gathering, why don't you close your eyes with me right now? Let's invite a spirit of wisdom and revelation into this moment. Holy Spirit, you're the best teacher. You're the revealer of truth. And I pray that this will be a timely word that will find its mark, find its place in the hearts and lives of everybody listening today. Let veils come off. Let truth be understood and received. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's talk about how can we start this year strong by having a healthy soul. You might think, well, shouldn't we be talking more about our spirit and that's the real key to having a great start to the year? Well, actually, the Bible does point to the soul area of your life. In fact, there was a moment where the disciples came to Jesus and they asked him, how come we can't seem to follow through on the things that we set out to do? How come we set out with the best intentions and we can't seem to follow right through to having a real life change in our lives? And Jesus opened up a window of wisdom that we're going to look at today when he said in Matthew 26:41, there it is, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. When we unpack that, what he was really saying, listen, I know that in your spirit, there is a willingness, but the issue is not in the spiritual area of your life, it's in this soul area. Your spirit is willing, but your flesh or your soul is weak. The word weak meaning lacking in strength. So Jesus is not questioning the willingness of your spirit. He's actually pointing to another area of your life, which is in fact your soul. And he's saying the reason why you can't follow through on the stuff that you set out to do is because your soul lacks the strength to give expression to what is in your spirit and that you're desiring to do from that place. So first of all, before we look through this window of wisdom that Jesus is giving us, let's make sure we're dealing with the right definition of what he meant by our soul area of our life. The first place in scripture where we read the word soul being referred to is actually at the time of creation. In Genesis 2 verse 7, it says, and the Lord God formed a man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. So your soul means the living person. It's when your mind, your will, and your emotion and your physical behavior all come into alignment and give one singular living expression of you as a person. That's a whole soul. That's a healthy soul. When your mind, will, emotion, and physical behavior are all in alignment, acting in integrity, acting in unity, that is a healthy soul. Now, we also need to just take a moment to draw a distinction between spirit and soul. In this verse we just read, the Bible says that you got your spirit from the Father of all spirits, the Ruah of God, the breath of God, the Spirit of God. He breathed that into you as a human being at the time of your conception, and you became a living soul in that moment. So the spirit that you have is actually given from God. So just like it's impossible for you to have an immature breath, I mean, check yourself right now. Is anybody immature breathing? You can't have an immature breath. So when God breathed into you the spirit of life, he didn't give you an immature spirit. It's a constant. It's not a variable. So the only part of you then that's prone to weakness and needs to mature is not your spirit, which has come from God, but actually your soul. Your spirit is a constant. The variable in your life is actually a different part of you: mind, will, emotion, physical behavior, your soul. And so Jesus is saying, guys, the reason why you struggle to bring about change in your life, the reason why you set out to do things and don't seem to be able to follow through, is not a lack of willingness from your spirit. It's actually your soul is weak to give expression to what your spirit wants to do. It's also worthy of note that when Jesus referred to the fact that we can have the pleasures of this world, to gain all the pleasures that this world can give, and yet we can lose our soul, he was not in fact referring to us missing out on heaven. This losing of the soul is something, a condition we can have right now. To lose your soul is to fracture your soul. You damage your soul. And he's saying, sure, you can go after all what this world has to offer you, all of its pleasures and success, etc. and so on. But if you have to fracture your soul, if you have to damage your soul, if you have to disconnect your mind, will, and emotion and compartmentalize your life in order to get that, to use deceit, to use lying and scheming and all those things, it's not worth it. You've lost your soul in order to gain all those things. So Jesus talking about losing your soul was not a reference so much to missing out on heaven, but a condition of life we can have now because we fracture those parts of our soul in order to get these things of success that the world's pointing at. So let's put it all together. When the disciples asked Jesus, why do we struggle to change our lives, even when we sincerely want to do things we can't seem to follow through? And Jesus says, listen, without question, I can see that your spirit is willing, but the problem is your soul lacks the strength to give expression to your spirit's willingness. So perhaps we've made the mistake of thinking that all of our struggles are spiritual. In fact, they lie in another domain altogether, and that is our soul. It's not that we're insincere about changing. You know that you're sincere about the changes you want to make in your life, the improvements you want to make in relationships, the things you want to leave behind in the previous year and do better this year. You are sincere. God knows you are. But he's actually pointing to the fact that your soul needs to be strong enough to support the willingness of your spirit. And so this is a major issue that we need to talk about, because your soul is in fact the bottleneck through which the expression of your spirit must pass. What do I mean by that? Well, right here, we've got this bottle. It's unquestionably got water in it. It's half full of water. We're not bringing into debate whether there's any water in here. The question remains, can the water get out? It's great that there's water in this bottle, but the benefit of it is not that it's kept within this bottle, but that it flows out. That's where the benefit is. And to get out, it must flow through the bottleneck. And so I'm saying that your soul is the bottleneck. It's the mind, will, and emotion. It's all that physical behavior as well, through which the willingness of your spirit must pass on its way to expression in everyday life. So your soul can cancel out all that your spirit desires to do. So we're confronted by the fact that in life, we can't go anywhere unless our soul is strong enough to support what our spirit wants to do. There's a scripture that I love in the book of Nehemiah, and it's chapter 4, verse 6. Nehemiah's standing back, the wall's half finished, and listen to what he says. Listen to where he's pointing. He says, so we built the wall. The entire wall was joined together up to half its height because the people had a mind to work. He's not saying, see, I told you everybody, it's the will of God. That's unquestionable. He's saying the will of God actually got done, not because we had faith in God, but because of the faithfulness of the people. He's not pointing to spirit, he's pointing to soul. Faith is a faculty of spirit. Faithfulness is a part of your soul. He's saying, listen, we actually got this done because the people got up in the morning, they committed, they followed through, they turned up in time on the wall, they worked, they skinned their knuckles. It was tough, it was hard work, and that's why they got it done, because the people had a strong soul to give expression to what God wanted to actually do. And you might be thinking, wait a minute, all my Christian life, I've been told that if I'm spiritually strong, I can overcome all these things that are challenging me in life. Well, actually, the Bible points to the soul being the primary battleground, your mind, your will, and your emotions being the primary battleground of your life. It says in 1 Peter Chapter 1, verse 22, dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. He's pointing to the primary place that you and I struggle are in our mind, in our will, and in our emotion. And as I've already pointed out, that's not spiritual, that's the area of soul. And that's why the Bible refers to our struggles as the work of the flesh, Galatians 5:19. And what happens is the enemy of our soul uses the areas of weakness in our soul to take advantage of us, to manipulate us. He sees that area in our soul where perhaps we're not that strong, and he actually amplifies it, uses it as leverage to dominate our lives in those ways. But it begins with a work of the flesh. All right, so how does a soul become weak? Well, it fractures itself. If ever you've played sport or watched sport and you've seen somebody with maybe their shoulder get dislocated, their arm immediately becomes weak, or one of their fingers on their hand is dislocated, it loses its strength immediately. It needs to stay in alignment in order to stay strong. And so when you fracture yourself, when you dislocate your mind, will, and emotion and behavior, your soul immediately becomes weak. You're weakening your soul when you lie to someone convincingly, because you're using your tone of voice, your facial expressions, and you've had to disconnect it from what your heart knows to be true in order to be a liar convincingly. You're weakening your soul when you hate someone with your emotions, but you, with your behavior, are pretending to like them. In order to do that convincingly, you have to dislocate the parts of your soul. You have to dislocate your head from your heart in order to pull off that sort of behavior. You're weakening your soul when you have feelings of emotionally wanting to punish somebody, but know that you need to act towards them in a certain way. You're hiding what your true heart is actually harboring emotionally inside yourself. And this is where we get people that are living in compartments. They fracture their soul. They have one set of values for their sex life, one set of values for their church life, one set of values for their social life and their work life. And it's like they're a different person. They have a different set of values in each one of these silo compartments. Well, they have to fracture their soul to do that. So like Jesus said, sure, you can go ahead and achieve a level of success by living like that, but you're going to lose your soul. You're going to damage your soul. You're going to weaken your soul in order to live that fractured sort of life. So let's talk about now, well, how do we strengthen our soul then? Well, we just reverse the process. What's been disaligned, we now bring into alignment. And this is something we constantly need to work at in our society. We live in a world and a culture that is constantly trying to fracture our souls. And so we need to maintain a lifestyle of nurturing health in our soul. And I'm going to give you three areas that you can work upon, that I work on in my life to bring alignment and strength to your soul. Number one, tell the truth to yourself, God, and others. The Bible says, behold, you desire truth in the inward parts. Therefore, give me understanding in my secret heart. See, when we're lying, as I've already pointed out, we're disconnecting the parts of your soul. When you start telling the truth to yourself, God, and others, you'll feel a rest coming into your soul, because you're relieving the tension you're putting your soul under by living with this constant tension and pressure that you're an imposter and one day you're going to get found out. So by speaking the truth to yourself, God, and others, you're bringing alignment. That which has been fractured, you're now bringing alignment. See, lots of people have got the wrong idea why God wants us to confess our sin, to come clean, to be truthful. It's not that he's upset because he's made up these rules and now we're breaking them. No, he knows you're a beautiful soul that he's created to function beautifully in life. And when he sees you lying, when he sees you living in areas of dishonesty, he knows you're violating, you're vandalizing, you're fracturing your soul. So number one, speak the truth to yourself, God, and others. Number two, and really this one is an extension of the previous one of personal honesty and truthfulness, and that is number two, take responsibility for your own experiences and stop blaming other people for it. When you blame other people for emotions that you're experiencing, you're actually disempowering yourself. You're weakening your soul to do that because you're empowering them with your happiness. You're saying, I can't be happy. You have the power of my happiness. You are disempowering yourself and giving that power to them. Stop doing that. Come on. God has given you the power and right to choose how everyone and everything outside of yourself affects you. Stop the blame game. Take responsibility for your own experiences and how you're experiencing life, how you're experiencing your marriage, how you're experiencing this present moment, wherever you're listening to this right now. You take responsibility for it, and immediately you'll feel alignment and strength coming to your life. As we just land this message, you might be listening to me and yet you're relating to everything I'm saying, but you have tried your best to bring alignment to your life, but you just can't seem to manage it. Well, that is the moment that we realize when we need help outside of ourselves. And we have a God who has promised to restore our soul. I love that phrase in Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, he restores my soul. God reaches past every part of your life. You might need physical healing, and yet he's reaching past your physical pain right now, and he's reaching for your soul because he knows your soul was in pain long before your body was, and your body's just mirroring, reflecting the pain that's in your soul. He restores our soul. And right now we're going to come to the one who's promised to do that. We're going to stand to our feet. Come on, everybody, everywhere in the lounge room. Maybe you're watching this on your own at home right now. Maybe you're like me and you fractured your soul without realizing it. You just wanted the emotional pain to stop and you achieved that. But now there's a numbness about your life and you want to feel again. You want to experience life again to the fullest. Let's come to the one that has promised to restore our soul. Maybe there you worked out a long time ago that people wanted you to be a certain type of person, and you fractured yourself to give them that person, but you haven't been yourself for years. Today, all that stops. Today, we're coming to the Lord, our God, who said, I can reach inside you. I can do what no other man, woman, or person or circumstance can do. I can restore your soul. So everybody, everywhere, come on, we're going to stand together. We're going to go to a time of worship now, and we're going to pray a prayer. This was what the lyrics of this song is all about. Come, Holy Spirit, fall afresh upon me. Only you can make me whole. Give me strength and make me grow. So come on, everybody. We're going to turn right now to the team, and they're going to lead us in this wonderful prayer that we're going to pray together. Close your eyes. Reach out your hands in front of you. Experience the restoration of your soul right now today. Holy Spirit, we invite you to come as only you can to the deepest recesses of our soul. Bring alignment where there's been fracturing. Bring healing where there's been pain. We open ourselves to you right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.